until the end of the talk. This month, we're honored to have Faisal Saeed Al-Matar, Iraqi atheist writer born in 1991. And, he had lots of fundamentalist death threats and et cetera, left the country and recently has immigrated to the United States. You know, really, he's the founder of the global secular humanist movement, and he has done actually so many things in terms of internet organizing that it was agreed that instead of me screwing up the introduction, I'd bring Faisal back in, and he can finish his introduction as to who he is. So please welcome Faisal.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Good afternoon.
Thank you all for coming here. I mean, that was actually a very short introduction, so I would go with a long one, which is actually not really long. What you mentioned is, yes, I was born in Iraq in 1991, June, right after the first Gulf War. So I must like to divide my life into four chapters. The first chapter, which starts from the moment I was born, until the second Gulf War, called Operation Iraqi Freedom, in 2003. Some people would not like to call it this way, would like to call it the invasion of Iraq. But I prefer the first title. I will explain in a while. The third chapter will be my exile period, which is from September 2009 until my arrival to my new home, the United States of America. And that happened just 3 months ago. So let me explain about the first chapter, which was a Saddam Hussein chapter that I was born in. Let me explain how life it is within that regime. I don't know if you are familiar with it, but so the moment you are born in Iraq, they issue you a birth certificate, just like any other nation. But what is the difference? The difference is that you get labeled by your parents' religion just one day after you were born. And your parents are all of the time tend to be Muslim because we're a majority Muslim countries. So you get labeled as a Muslim the moment you are born, whether you like it or not. And then with it comes the last name, which suggests your tribal name or the tribe that you belong to, which actually these two main factors decide your own future in Iraq. Especially now in the Civil War, which started after Nazi intervention, which you got killed based upon your ID. So the moment you are born, you got issued your birth certificate, and within the birth certificate as well, you are also a part of an army called the Quds Army, which is supposedly to liberate Palestine. So you are born without. So it seems like consent is not the idea within Saddam Hussein regime. You are born into a state of fear. Everything that you do, everything that you say against the regime, the happy thing may happen to you is to get a death penalty. The internet, all forms of communication were all controlled by the government. Actually, there was no such a thing as internet. There was intranets in which you can only access Iraqi government websites, in which you can see how great Saddam Hussein was. And there is only two channels which are controlled by the government as well. You have no right to access any international channel because that will also put you in a death penalty. So you can have only two channels in which Saddam appears 10 hours a day, in which you have to see how great and how wonderful he is. We start schooling in Iraq by the age of 6. So the first thing you start with is that when the first teacher comes in, you have to stand up and say, "Long live Saddam Hussein, may God protect him." That is the thing that you have to do every day in your schooling years. You stand up for Saddam Hussein, you tell him, "May God," which is obviously imaginary, to protect him. And what else? What also needs to be mentioned about that totalitarian regime is that all the education, obviously, is controlled by Saddam. Saddam Hussein, as you know, was a socialist. There was no such thing as private schooling, no way that you can run away from government education, in which you have the picture of Saddam and verses of the Quran of each chapter, whether it was a biology book or a... So there's no controversy about evolution right there. Just to make sure, I was actually in San Diego just a few weeks ago for the AHA conference, and I was talking with Richard Dawkins about how ridiculous education in Iraq, and that's all mostly because of the result of Saddam, is evolution had been put in a very small chapter in which it's put with Lamarckism and all other theories which are disproven. And what the teacher said, my biology teacher said, as I remember, I told Richard Dawkins about it, who actually tweeted, my biology teacher said that evolution, the theory of evolution, was created by the Jews and Americans to deceive the Muslim youth. Okay? So that explains why the majority, obviously, of the Iraqi population have no understanding whatsoever of evolution, because that is, it's like one of the things that the regime does, and most of the totalitarian regimes in the Middle East, what they do is whenever things go wrong, they blame America and the Jews. And that explains a lot about, and that's what gets me interested in writing about foreign policy and US foreign policy, as well as what situation, because there has been a lot of misunderstanding about what people refer to as a source of extremism, and that's the question of why do they hate us that always show up in the news, Wall Street Journal, and others, like why there is this clash of civilization, why 9/11 happened, why all this terrorism exists. And I've done my research, I've done my best to explain why do these things, and I've came to the conclusion, and I could be wrong about it, but I think I'm most accepted advice. Who wants to argue with me, take my number and give a call, is that I think that religion, an organized religion, is one of the main source of hatred in the world. And I believe that organized religion has played the major, is the major reason why terrorism happens. I found that there is so much correlation between what people believe and what people do. There has been a lot of misunderstanding whenever you talk about things happened like 9/11 or Boston bombing, the lately one, or even though they say, oh, well, because US foreign policy, we invaded their lands, they got pissed off, and they blow us up. That has been the explanation done by many American, unfortunately, I'm sorry to say, they're American, most of them, that they want always to take religion out of the discussion. They say, no, it's not religion, it's mostly economics, it's mostly political. And I've been in the discussion with them. So let's try to apply some logic here. I want to test my theory and see if it was about economics or politics, as some people like to argue, then would somebody blow himself up for economics? I haven't seen a socialist suicide bomb or a capitalist suicide bomb. because if the main reason here, as some people argue, that it's mostly economic reasons, people would not blow themselves up for money. Because how much money you can offer for a suicide bomber is a lose-lose business. How much money you can offer to a suicide bomber, he's gonna die. So obviously the economic reason is out of the discussion here, because people don't do. And then the second one would be the political reason, is that they say, okay, when the United States intervened, they got pissed off, and all of that is politics. Then how do you explain that women's rights are the worst in the Muslim world? Is this also United States foreign policy? Is this also George W. Bush? Is this also Barack Obama? Because it's very easy nowadays to blame America for everything, every shit happens in the Middle East. There has been always a discussion that it is, and that's actually used by many of Muslim apologists, in which they try what I call the shifting of the blame, which is a shift the responsibility from what the Muslim should do, or what the Muslim world, especially the Middle East, and what America should do. No one, all the time, people ask the question, what America should do to the Middle East? But no one asks the question, what the Middle East should do to America? What the people in that part of the world, which I belong to, should do to create a peaceful and prosperous world. The shift of the blame obviously have been not a solution. And the war on terror started from 2001 until today, and there has been no solution. Because nobody actually, in my opinion, recognizes the problem that religion plays a major role in that clash of civilization. And because of religion has been taken a free ride of our criticism, we are having what we are having. Is that never criticize religion. And now, there's a thing that pisses me off a lot, is that many people consider Islam to be a race, which is absurd, and which has been used a lot by the Muslim apologists as well, is that when you criticize Islam, you are labeled as a racist or a bigot, which is a very good way that they can shelter and put a shield against criticism of Islam, because it's a very good, actually in America, I've been living there for a while, the best way to shut somebody's argument is to call him a racist.
That's right.
Especially if he was white. if you are losing the argument, just call the other person a racist and you win the argument. And you've got many people on your side. It just works. This is America's miracle. It just works. You can just play that card. Whether it's true or not true. I mean, I'm not in any sense denying that there is racism in America. I'm not in any sense denying that there is some discrimination against people from ethnic minorities. It exists in every country. That is a fact of life. But what these people are trying to use, whether they are American Muslim organizations or Muslim apologists who mostly tend to be liberal, they use this argument. Oh, you're criticizing Islam, therefore you hate people who are brown skinned. Which is absurd as hell, but it works. And that's also one of the reasons that I think that at the moment that they are actually winning the argument. Because Islam had been protected very much by Muslims and by the Muslim apologists to the way that it has been taken out of that discussion. And the problem has not been solved, which is how we can have a global society that is peaceful and that is prosperous, and how we can create a relation between the Western world and the Muslim world. Because many people leave religion out of the discussion. They say, no, it's all not about religion. That's one of the things I've been writing about. That's one of the things I've been fighting for a very long time. It put me in a lot of danger, obviously. Because I used to write about that when I was in Iraq, and when I left Iraq and got also to Muslim majority countries, because that unfortunately I was actually applying to go to the United Kingdom, but it didn't work out. But I said, okay, I'm gonna continue writing, because if I'm going to surrender, if I'm going to give up, that means they won. I don't want to give them that. That is the culture that they want to create. They want to create a culture of fear. They want to create a culture which I refer to as a culture of terror. Is that you can never create a discussion. You can never discuss Islam. Islam has been very much immune from criticism, because the Muslim thinks it's immune from criticism. And I see it more, to me, as a battle of freedom of speech. Is that that humans, my opinion, humans have rights, but beliefs do not. Beliefs should be discussed, and should be discussed on an intellectual level. But that is what seems to be the Muslims do not understand at the moment, is that they think that their religion is somehow, like while I studied some IT, I look at it from a software level. So they think like their religion is software 3.0, and Christianity is software 2.0, and Judaism is -3 because I hate the Jews, and atheism is -6. So they think of their religion as somehow far superior than all other religions, which is obviously one of the biggest problems that we are facing. And the best way to see that, I mean, people call me, you exaggerate, and you are a hater and Islamophobic, and you, I get this love letters all the time. The best way to prove that I'm right, just draw a cartoon or write an article against Islam and see what happens.
Yeah. Draw Muhammad Day on YouTube.
Despite the fact that I'm not actually a very huge supporter of having these cartoons, but at the same time, the best way to test Muslim reception to freedom of speech is to do it. And there will be, the protests will be right away, and the embassies will be burned, and Benghazi is one of the latest ones. And I also asked a question. I was actually having a debate with a Muslim association, and I said, like, why don't the Muslims, other than waging a jihad against America, why don't they wage the jihad against poverty? And I was called Islamophobic because of it.
What?
Why don't they wage a jihad? Why we don't see protests of Muslim protesting against discrimination against women in Saudi Arabia, for example, in which women are not allowed to drive? Or in Iran, which is also a Muslim majority country, in which women cannot, they have to cover their hair, and otherwise they will be called, quote unquote, immodest. And leave aside the huge discrimination against women in Iran. I was actually talking with an Iranian activist just a few weeks ago. She told me about something that scares me up, is that when they capture a woman in Iran who has been committed a crime against the Ayatollahs, is if she was a virgin, what they do is, if they say that if we apply the death penalty to a virgin, she's going to go to heaven. So what they do is that they rape her, and then they apply the death penalty so she can go to hell. And I was shocked when she told me this. But this is actually happening in Iran at the moment. And that is a country that is on the merge of acquiring nuclear weapons. One of the Ayatollahs, even said that they want to wipe Israel out of the map. He said something which I think was published on New York Times, who said, like, if we're gonna acquire a nuclear weapon and if we're gonna attack United States and we kill about 5 million Americans and they attack us back and they kill all the Iranians will go to heaven and Americans will go to hell. So it's like a win-win situation. And then that is one of the reasons why actually I am continuous in my advocacy against organized religion, especially religious extremism, because I have seen it in my eyes what are the results of religious extremism. I'm 22 at the moment. My birthday was just a few days ago. When I grew up in my high school, and that was in 2006-2007, I used to take a bus to my school, and the 2006-2007 were what's referred to as the peaks of the civil war, which happened between the Sunnis and Shia. Because of the civil war, the bus used to stop near a place in which they closed the street with dead bodies. And you have to walk on the dead bodies every day to go to school. And that was my situation for 2 years. And how what is the civil war? Let me give you a brief description of it. So Saddam Hussein was a Sunni leader. He was from the Sunni Islam sect. So he had been holding power for a very long time, and then he fell down. And during his regime, he was discriminating a lot against the Shia Muslims, attacking them from time to time. Most of the government used to be occupied by Sunnis, and he used chemical weapons also against the Kurds in northern Iraq, as I don't know if you're familiar with Halabja and others, and which created a lot of hatred, a lot of revenge within the Shia and the Kurds population. When he fell down, when the United States came in, everything went into chaos. All sides are fighting. The Shias are looking for revenge. Finally, we got rid of the Sunni leader. Now it's time for us. And the Shia represent the majority of Iraq. They represent about 60%. And the Sunni represent the minority. And because that happened, is that the Shias came into power. And obviously, they're not going to give a place to the Sunnis because they're full with revenge. And that, here where the democracy does not seem to work, is that, the Iraqi elections are pretty much, the first Iraqi elections in 2005 pretty much worked on demographics. The Shias vote for Shias, the Sunnis vote for Sunnis, and the Kurds vote for Kurds. I mean, if you look at the statistics, how many Shias in Iraq, you can dive and see how many Shia parties won. It is pretty much sectarian. So the elections happened in 2005, the Shias held the majority of the parliament as well as the prime minister, and the Sunnis obviously felt discriminated. The Sunnis brought their militias, and the Shias brought their militias, and most of the war happened in Baghdad, when I grew up. And so what they do is that their militias control areas in Baghdad, and they stand in the middle of the street. They create some kind of false checkpoints. So the Iraqi ID, when I said like the birth certificate is based, the ID is based on the birth certificate, in which it shows your religion and your last name. So from your last name, you can actually know whether someone is a Sunni or a Shia. That's how it works. So the false checkpoint stands in the middle of the street. You give them your ID. If you go to a Sunni militia and you are a Shia, you get killed, and vice versa. And that explains why this dead body. Because my school was in central west Baghdad, and that area is where Sunni areas and Shia areas come together. So whenever the Shias pass the highway, they get killed, and whenever the Sunnis pass the highway, they get killed. So the street all gets closed by the dead bodies of both sides. And whenever you're trying to explain that, you get the criticism that you hate God, and you hate people who are brown skinned, and you hate, and nobody's actually talking about it. No one wants to say that these people believe this, and they act upon what they believe. This is not related to the United States, Israel, whatever. If it was the case, as what some people argue, then why they are killing each other? And if you want, just look how Iraq was in the August World War. Look at now what Syria is. Syria, let me explain. I'll explain now about the current events, what happened in the United States trying to support the rebels. So what happened is that the revolution started in 2011. Most of the people who actually marched at the beginning were the people that I think most of you will support, because most of them are liberals, educated, they want human rights, they want free elections, etc., etc. What happened is that the Alawite regime, which Alawite is a sect of Shia Islam, which is supported by Iran and Hezbollah in Lebanon. And the other people, the rebels, are the Sunnis. And both of them united for the first time ever to kill all the liberals and to kill all the educated. Because they're all united on that part. And which they're both united to. So the first good guys who actually marched for true democracy, they were looking for democracy, free elections, human rights, etc. But they were killed by both sides. Because both sides do not want these people to succeed. So the good guys have been killed. What is left at the moment, which I think is disastrous for the United States to intervene, it's now a battle of two evils. It's between Shia radicals, the Alawite concept, not radicals, but the people who support them, Iran, Hezbollah, are pretty much the case. And the Sunnis, who are supported by Saudi Arabia and Qatar, in which women are not allowed to drive, so they're not obviously our allies. And the United States is going, and now, like, in my opinion, and I've written also about this, is that the United States should have intervened in 2011, at least in support of these highly educated liberals and secularists. Otherwise, if it's going to intervene now, what's going to do? Nothing. And it's going to intervene against two people who hate them. I mean, regardless of who you're going to support, whether it was an Assad regime, whether it was rebels, which, and obviously the United States is going to support the rebels, you're supporting people who kill women for going to school, and are you sure that you want to support these guys? I mean, was it a mistake that happened in Afghanistan that actually eventually created what created and 9/11 came as a result? I mean, U.S. foreign policy needs a reformation here. We need, I'm tired of the enemy of my enemies, my friend. It doesn't work. So what I'm trying to do, as an individual, and I'm going to speak about the social humanist movement later on, what I'm trying to do as an individual, as a person who comes from that part of the world, is to try to recruit the good guys and let the United States support them. And let me explain what I mean by the good guys. The good guys are the people who at least in some sense hold an understanding of what human rights is and what freedom is. Because the rebels, quote unquote, and Bashar al-Assad have no understanding whatsoever. And the people who are fighting at the moment are not going to bring human rights, are not going to bring anything benign to these countries. These countries, just like what happened in Iraq, you're going to get rid of the dictator and you got the Islamists after it. And that is the case of the so-called Arab Spring, or what some crackpots call the Arab Awakening, which has nothing to do with awakening. Is that, why do they still happen? In order for dictatorship to survive, and that is the case in Iraq, Syria, Egypt, Libya, all of these countries. In order for this dictatorship to survive, they try to make as much stupid people as possible. That's how they can survive. Otherwise, tyranny, that is how tyrannical regimes is able to continue, is to make create a group of people that are not able to do critical thinking, that are not able to do, and the best way to do it is censor the media, censor information, let people as uneducated, as ignorant as possible, so they can follow them and they can easily get controlled. So you've got these people in these parts of the world. And then these people, the main reason why they are protesting at the moment is to get food on the table. They don't have a set of principles. We're not talking about the American Revolution or the French Revolution, which was talked about in MSNBC, in which someone compared the Arab Spring to American Revolution, and I thought that guy was high. is absurd. The people who are protesting got no idea what freedom of religion is, what freedom of speech is. They just want food on the table. The protesters, and not all of them, obviously. Some of them actually are educated, but the educated factor in Egypt, for example, are not organized. They're not organized. The secularists, the liberals, etc., are not organized. So who is organized? The Muslim Brotherhood. And the Muslim Brotherhood, after the dictatorship of some decades by Mubarak, the dictatorship fell down, Islamists directly came after. Because ignorant people elect ignorant people like them. And that's how the so-called Arab Spring existed. If the United States in any way is going to intervene, it should not intervene in support of the same status quo. It should not support the problem itself. The Islamists are not our allies, period. It's period. Because, and if you're gonna go to support this type of people, what you're gonna get is the opposite results. One example I can easily refer to is Pakistan. Pakistan receives billions of dollars of U.S. aid. Billions of dollars. And this country got the nuclear weapons, which is scary. And where was Osama bin Laden found again?
Pakistan.
This is a country that supports, that gets a lot of money, a lot of support from the U.S., and is quote-unquote ally of the U.S. And see what they do. Giving money to the wrong guys and hiding one of the most dangerous enemies to the United States. And the same goes, like now there was a recent shipment of F-16 and other weaponry to Egypt, Muslim Brotherhood. And one of the latest, there was some guy in the parliament in Egypt said that we should destroy the pyramids because they represent paganism. And we're talking here about one of the most important parts of a human heritage, of a human civilization, which are the pyramids. And these are people are getting money from the United States. How does that make any sense? I mean, it's absurd as hell. So anyway, that is from policy part. I would like to talk about, which is what Larry mentioned about the global secret humanist movement. So in September 2010, actually, I sat down with myself and I looked at the world, tried to do some analysis, and I tried to figure out a solution for that world. So I created what I call global secular humanist movement. The main mission of it, when I it has now a very large manifesto. You can read it because it's going to take more than 3 hours to explain. But I'm going to speak what is actually the main mission. The main mission would be to create a global society that is inspired by love and humanism and guided by reason and knowledge, because that's what we need at the moment. What we need is the critical thinkers, what we need are problem solvers, what we need are humanists. People who care about this planet and care about this life. People who believe in life after birth, not life after death. That is what we need, because, and why do I mention the life after death? When people believe that there is a life after death, and this life is immortal, they are not going to appreciate this life. That is common sense. When people realize that their life on this world is limited, that is part of the human psychology, that they appreciate things. I'll give you a simple example. If you have $1,000, or someone promising you with $1 million, the people who know that they only have $1,000 will take care more of the $1,000 than the people who think that they get a $1 million at the end. Because they know that that is only what they have. They will say, you know what, I'm not going to spend this, that I have all limited money, I have to take care of it. But when someone is promised with $1 million, they're like, okay, I'm going to buy this expensive cell phone with $1,000. Because I'm going to get $1 million in a few hours. And that's what happens with religion. And that is what I think is the main argument can be used about religion, is that people think that the idea of heaven and hell are benign, which I don't think is the case. Because within the heaven and hell, what is being rewarded is following non-critical thinking. God punishes you for thinking, but rewards you for following. The religion does not operate on who made the world a better place. What religion rewards is how much you follow Jesus or follow the commandments of Allah. And that's why I mean, thankfully, I've been a non-believer since the moment I started to know how to read. I started reading philosophy since a very young age, from I think age of 8, despite the fact that most of the books were banned, but I tried to get them illegally, just like alcohol. So from a very young age, I started reading about mostly Greek philosophy, Socrates and Plato and others. And this, when I started reading these books, and I started reading the quote-unquote the holy books, they didn't make sense. Like, even though I used to believe in some sense of a supernatural, I used to call him the supreme intelligence. And I used to believe that everything that is intelligent in this world is a result of quote-unquote that God. But then my conversion story goes that I thought that I made God in my own image, which is actually everyone does. it is what all religious people do. I take it from him. He said, "I'm a creationist. I believe that man created God," which is the case. Is that I still believe that God is a supreme intelligence because I was interested in science and philosophy since a very young age, and I created God in that image. I used to think that the science is the language of God. The more we understand science, the more we understand about God. Then, thanks to Stephen Hawking, who said that God was unnecessary, so I said, I don't have much to draw. It's only God I made, so let's be an atheist for a while. So I became an atheist by age 18, and I started, but I think the most conversion happened to me is to convert from an atheist to anti-theist and a humanist. This is, I think, my conversion story. It's not, I've never been a Muslim, despite the fact that many people think that just because I'm from Iraq, that means I'm a Muslim, which I find insulting. Obviously it's the case that I'm not blaming the people who use generalizations, even though that all generalizations are false, including this one, as my twin said. Unfortunate is that we live in a society that is does not allow us to be who we are, and that's one of the reasons why I immigrated to the United States. Actually, I'm a refugee. The word immigrant may not apply to me because immigration may have some sense of consent. My eldest brother was killed in Iraq, and my cousin as well, and my best friend was killed because he was mistaken by me when I got the death threat. So I came here as a humanitarian refugee basis, not as a coming as an immigrant in which you come by the passport. Even though I'm legal refugee, don't take it the wrong way. So what here to mention is that you can actually, I mean, here the problem is that, so I got so many questions about it. It was like, how many atheists you think that are there in Iraq or in the Middle East? Is that the problem is that you can never know, and you will never know. Because all the statistics work are based upon the government issued ID, and you have no right to change what your ID is. I mean, if you go to the Ministry of Justice and tell them I want to change my religion into atheism, I don't know if you're going to keep your head in your body. So the idea that you can actually know how many atheists in statistics, in numbers, in that part of the world, it cannot happen. And that is one of the reasons why actually, which is I put as my 2015 goal of the Global Secular Movement, is to work on a global level, at least in the United Nations, to pass a bill that allows freedom of religion in all member states of the United Nations. That is the only way in which atheists and religious minorities can have their rights protected in that part of the world. Because in Sharia law and within Muslim countries, minority rights is not a subject of discussion. I mean, whatever the problem is that atheists are not all the people who are discriminated against, to be honest. I'm trying to be, is that in Iraq we used to have 5% Christians. Now it's 0.5%. The majority of Iraqi Christians either had their churches burned or members of their family killed. So you can actually see more Iraqis now in California, San Diego, than you see them in Iraq. They're actually now, like a lot of Iraqi refugees who actually came the same way, who mostly come from Christians. Now, the discrimination mostly goes not merely against atheists, it's against non-Muslims. So whether you are, anything that is a non-Muslim is a person that is in danger in Iraq. I leave aside that if you are born in the wrong sect and you live in the wrong district, you're also in the Darija. I mean, everyone actually in Iraq is in the Darija. I don't want to personalize that I'm the only person who is in danger of Iraq and I escaped like a hero, like a Superman. Actually, the majority of the people killed in Iraq are Muslims. It is most of the, here when the argument said, when people argue against the Iraq war and they say, United States killed 300,000 Iraqis. That's false. That's false, actually, because 99.9% of all the killings are done by the civil war. So to shift the blame, and that's what I mentioned about the Muslim apologists, is that they shift the blame back to the United States. And they can win the argument that they say there is no civil war in Iraq, and there is no killing between Sunnis and Shias, and America screwed everything, and it's all because of George W. Bush. And this argument actually is valid in many states. So, it's very easy working on what's referred to in psychology as the confirmation bias, in which that it's easier to blame Bush because you know him as an American than to blame the people living in Iraq, because the majority of Americans obviously do not understand what's going on in Iraq, but they know Bush. So it's easier to blame Bush than to blame the Muslim leaders, because it requires a lot of explanation to explain the situation in Iraq than to explain how Bush does mistakes. So, and I think that this chapter of history needs to be understood. And that's what also the reason why I speak a lot about what's going on in Iraq, because it's, I refer sometimes as the Iraqi Holocaust. Is that now, every day, like you check the news, 40 to 50 people killed. And that is, by the way, that is only the Ministry of Health reported deaths. Most of the people that I have seen dead, and I wrote a lot of them in my diary, actually, when people ask you about evidence and they ask about news reports, I can't provide them with none. Mainly because most of the deaths in Iraq are actually non-reported. They're non-reported. What you hear in the news is just the people who are lucky. There's a Iraqi proverb says, you are lucky if when you are dead, you get reported. The majority of deaths are not reported in Iraq. Because most of these areas, during the Civil War, are controlled by militias and controlled by Al-Qaeda, like Al-Qaeda and the Mahdi Army and others. No reporter can actually access this part of these areas. So to the ways that they get the dead bodies and they throw them in the river or something else, and no one reports this kind of stuff. So whatever numbers you can get, whether it was online or from news report, at least multiply them by 5 to get the real number. And I'm saying here at least. And that is the same case goes for Syria at the moment. Because Iraq death, when we reached the peaks of death, were mostly 2006, 2007. After 2008, things started to get better. What I mean by get better is that deaths dropped from 1,000 to 500, which is good. I mean, if you are speaking about that situation, then you consider things are getting better in some sense when you have 50% less deaths than than others. But so here, I think very good tip for you when you're trying to do research about Iraq and you try. Never trust the numbers. Always say that this is the least, because this is how the reporting goes in Iraq. When the reporting goes, it has to be the issue of a death certificate, and there's a lot of corruption there. So actually, the numbers are merely useless, in my opinion. Because if you want to know more about this, just ask a person who's living there. He got much more information than what the news reports are, because the news reports mostly get biased. So, but here's also, I think, what is now positive about I refer mostly as positive, is that the advantage of globalization that we're living in at the moment is that we're living in a world in which information can be processed much easier. So it's good that now the people around the world, especially in influential countries like the United States, can actually know what's going on there. Before, that was not the case. So with technology has actually helped, if it's going to be used the right way, to create a change. And that's, I think, one of the reasons to actually go with the humanist movement, in which I started, as I said, in 2009. I was the only person who followed this page, the only person who subscribed. By this month, I'm going to reach 200,000 from 150 countries. This is the beauty of the 21st century. And we have to use it to make the world a better place. How we can, how, the question is, how are we going to do it? Is by uniting the good guys, the humanists of the world, and drive action accordingly. Because if we are not going to save the world, who's going to do it? The suicide bomber? This is, I see, to me, I mean, the reason why I'm doing it, this is a moral responsibility. I'm not going to expect that the same person who sent me the death threat is the same person who's going to make a life a better place. This is my responsibility, and this is your responsibility. Is that if we are not going to, do these major things like freedom of religion in these countries and freedom of speech, and at least maintain some basic human needs in this part of the world, nothing is going to change. And the deaths are going to continue. And in my opinion, history is going to judge us pretty hard, because we have seen evil, but we have done nothing. That is, so I spoke a lot a little bit, but so I mentioned, okay. So, and here's, I think, what actually Sam Harris referred to it. Actually, that's the last chapter of my speech, so I'll give you more time for Q&A. Is that it's called the problem of liberalism. And why as many people have been so critical of liberals, not liberals in terms of economical, that they support big government or social programs, but liberals in terms of how they communicate the Muslim problem or the Islam problem. And I mentioned about it in the beginning about their trying to shift the problem into it. And that has been a problem that Sam Harris, as you know, the author of Liberal Landscape and the End of Faith, have been put into, as well as many of us who write against Islam, is that what is, I think, wrong with liberals is that they think all people think like them. And they expect, I believe in all what the liberals say, of things like multiculturalism and diversity and things like this. But the problem with liberalism is that they don't recognize that the other part of the world, especially now talking about the Muslim world, is that they don't think the same way. They don't think the same way. And I think the liberals should be the people who actually talk about the problems of Islam and not leave it to the Pastor Jones, crazy nuts like him and Alex Jones, to speak about the dangers of Islam. I think that secularists and liberals have shifted the responsibility for nut jobs to speak about Islam, which both of them in that conflict are nuts. Is that the Christian right believe that there is a war between Islam and Christianity, and Jesus is going to come back sometime soon if Christians won the battle. And the Muslims believe the same thing. And we secularists are left behind, because none of us is actually addressing this problem. Many of the liberals have never talked about Islam. You see all the liberals, I've been to so many conferences, atheist conferences, never, no discussion about Islam. Christianity. Islam is out of the discussion, most of the time. And a very best example would be when the Danish cartoons happened. Mm-hmm. All liberal magazines, New York Times and other, never published the cartoons. Mm-hmm. They did not. They're afraid of two things. One of them, I think, is legitimate. One is not offending Muslims, which is absurd. Second one is that they are fearful of Muslims, which I think is pretty legitimate. But that is actually the problem. That is a problem. When they say that Islam is the origin of peace, but they are afraid of publishing a cartoon because the origin of peace is going to... That explains it. That explains it. I believe that... I believe in multiculturalism as well, and all of the issue of diversity. But in my opinion, as a humanist, I believe that any culture that goes against human rights are not culture worth of respect. Humans have rights, culture do not. Culture can be shifted, can evolve, can be criticized, but if we are going to stop, we do not discuss the issue of Islam, the deaths are going to continue, and women will not have rights in the Muslim world. Gays, nobody talks about them, obviously. I mean, in some countries of the Middle East, homosexuality is criminalized. It's a federal, there's a capital punishment in countries like Iran, which is, you get a death penalty for claiming that you're homosexual. Even that they sometimes put that charge into straight people who go against the regime and they call them homosexual, and therefore they're allowed to be killed. If we're not going to discuss Islam, if we, the secularists and the atheists, because we are the rational people in this world, if we're not going to discuss it, we're going to leave it into the wrong people to call it. This is, I mean, I think that the Christian right are right when they talk about Islam, but they're right for the wrong reasons. But we are right for the right reasons. And I want you to join me in making the world a better place. And thank you for listening. Wow.